Good evening, welcome to the August meeting of the Salinas Police Community Advisory Committee. We will start with pledge allegiance with Wayne Shepherd.
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. And roll call.
We'll swear them in first so that they're part of roll call.
Okay, we're going to swear in two new members first, then do roll call.
So it's ladies and gentlemen, my pleasure to welcome Mr. Tom Lynch and Ms. Melissa Sussman. Where did Melissa go? Come on, if you'd like to step up, and I think it'd probably be better if, let's see. Do this. So please raise your right hands and repeat after me. I state your name.
I, Tom Lynch.
Solemnly swear or affirm.
Solemnly swear and affirm.
That I will support and defend.
That I will support and defend.
The Constitution of the United States.
The Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
Against all enemies.
Against all enemies.
Foreign and domestic.
Foreign and domestic.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance.
To the Constitution of the United States.
To the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
That I take this obligation freely.
That I take this obligation freely.
Without any mental reservation.
Without any mental reservation.
Or purpose of evasion.
Or purpose of evasion.
And that I will well and faithfully.
And that I will well and faithfully.
Discharge the duties.
Discharge the duties.
Upon which I am about to enter.
Upon which I am about to enter.
Congratulations and welcome aboard.
Thank you.
Member, if you're seated, then we can participate in our roll call.
Okay, we'll wait just a moment. And we seem to be setting a record tonight for the largest audience we've ever had at PCAC.
Richard Force.
Here.
Will Frenzel.
Here.
Mary Hill.
Here.
Linda Payne.
Here.
Eric Peterson.
Here.
Dolores Gate Higgins.
Here.
Wayne Shepherd.
Present.
Dwight Metcalf.
Here.
Karen Aramo.
Present.
Melissa Sussman.
Present.
Tom Lynch.
Here.
Thank you. We're going to take an item out of order here. This is going to be the discussion item on the RMS system, and the presentation will be by Tracy Molfina, who is a contractor now, used to be a police commander here, and is the reason we had for many years a very good website, among other accomplishments.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and members of the PCAC. Back in,
we have to plug it in.
Over there? Can you hear me now?
No, you're not clear.
No.
We didn't do the electrical technician.
Chief, there you go. I am all about technology, aren't I? In July of this year, City Council authorized a contract between a company called TriTech Software Systems and the City of Salinas to implement a new records management system for the Salinas Police Department. Records management for us at the Police Department means everything from police reports to traffic citations to field interview cards, Anything that goes on a piece of paper that gets attached to a police report is a record, and we're required to maintain those records and have them accessible for investigations, for court purposes, and for archival. And it had been well over 30 years since the last update of our records management system. The officers, everybody from the chief through the officer patrol level to our records, to our statisticians, and everybody throughout the agency had been using a very antiquated system, and a lot of it was paper. So that's how old it was. The computerized system that was maintained, or is still maintained by the city information systems, for those of you who remember, is very DOS-looking, very non-user-friendly, and the ability was not there for users to get out information that they needed to do crime analysis and investigate crimes properly. So the council authorized the contract. This was based on development of a request for proposal from all the users within the police department for a new records management system based on best practices within the industry, within public safety. To give you a little background on our 30-year-old system that's being replaced, it currently maintains 655,000 police reports. Over 500,000 police reports are contained in that system. We currently have about 230 pieces of evidence in a separate system, so 230,000 pieces of evidence in a separate system. And we have about 436,000 person records in a separate system. So they're all separately maintained, whether it's paper, scanned paper, hard copy paper, or in this old computer system that needed to come together. So this new system is driven by a single system that is in the industry standard from a company called Tritech. It's meets the requirements today and meets the requirements in the future, both for investigations, for archival of police information, for crime analysis, and in some respects, public access. And I'll talk about that in just a minute. Tritech, the company, just very briefly, it's based out of San Diego. They have about 3,000 customers nationwide. They do CAD systems, which is the 911 systems, and they are the new 911 CAD provider for Monterey County. Previously, before this happened, all the 911, when you called 911 and a record was started that you needed a police officer, needed a firefighter, it would go into their system and we would have no connection to our system. So any attempted crime analysis or analyzing calls for service was zero or almost non-existent. So this new technology allows us to pull their data into our data and do that analysis and look to see if we're doing officer beats appropriately, manpower and staffing appropriately, investigations for 911 calls, all that sort of thing. I'm going to pass up, in the interest of time, pass up some of these and get to the meat and potatoes. In addition to the records management system being available to officers and users of the police station, that is available now in a mobile, or will be available in a mobile environment. So an officer in his car, in his or her car, on a mobile device, will be able to access police report information, arrest information, driver's license information in a much more unified fashion and in a mobile environment. The contract is a full suite of integration services from installation to interfaces with all the state and federal databases to training to support, and so that all users in the police department will be trained in how to use the system. It's a 24-hour support. We have disaster recovery built in, which we don't have now. The only disaster recovery is that the main brains of the system is behind a locked door in City Hall. So the new system has a separate off-site facility that a disaster recovery in case we have a fire here, we have an earthquake, and we need to maintain those records. The timeline for implementing this records management system, the contract was signed in July. The hardware is being installed now, And training begins in our spring AOT, our advanced officer training in the spring. There'll be 2 days worth of training for all the officer users, and then role-based training for everybody else. That's in the spring, with the full system going online in July of next year. So again, that's every piece of evidence and property that an officer brings in, that a police report that's written, a citation, a field interview card, a photograph, a mugshot. It will now all be in this one system that goes live in July of next year that officers will be able to access. And crime analysis, which has been pretty non-existent for us on the technical side, will be built in to this system. Budgetary, just to give you the numbers real quick, the total project is a $2.2 million project. It was funded by Measure G funds. The contract with Tritech, who is doing the software, is $1.3 million. And project management, about $138,000. Equipment, it's about $240,000. Interfaces to the state and federal databases, the 911, is about another $230,000 to $240,000. So again, all Measure G funds. And this is kind of hard to see on a big screen, but the new records management system is web-based. And when an officer or a user logs in, they'll come up to this the web browser, and it's based on their role, whether they're a property and evidence person, patrol officer, community service officer. It will bring up the information that they need, either to write a police report or conduct an investigation or do a crime analysis. This is sort of a screenshot of how an officer writes a report. Right now, when an officer or a user writes a police report, they fill out a four-page piece of paper, handwritten. Then they dictate into a tape recorder or into their iPod. Now it's an iPod, I'm sorry. And it gets sent to our word processing people. And they type up the information, and they look at the piece of paper with all the 4 pages worth of paper, and they type it into the system, into the old system. And there is very little checking of accuracy of that information. Is really left up to the word processing operator. And when they've entered it, when they've typed all the information, typed the narrative, they print it out on a hard copy. It goes to the officer supervisor or the watch commander, depending on the type of report. And they sit at the desk and they read paper after paper after paper. And that's just the process that's taking place. It's all paper driven. The new system is online. It's the officers will be entering the lion's share of the information now and validating that Joe is the same Joe. They'll be able to do searches, look at mugshots at the same time, confirm identity, and be able to type smaller reports themselves and speed up the process, have more accurate, more valid information. Supervisors don't have to go to the station to read reports. They can do it in the field. They can do it from a mobile device, approve reports. And there's also a crime analysis component to this. This is one of the crimes, it's very hard to see, but there's also a mobile version of crime analysis called Near Me that we have purchased. So officers will have this on a mobile device. So for instance, if there is a burglary problem identified in a certain area by a crime analyst, they'll be able to put it on an application where all the officers have access to it. They'll have all the background information to why that's a problem. They'll have all the field interviews, all the contacts, all the arrests made in that area, and be able to use that information to determine what kind of enforcement, what kind of activity, what kind of contacts they need to make in the field closer where they need to be. Crime analysis, comp stat, if you've heard the term, and that is accountability at the lowest level possible for your beats, your districts, your area commands, and the city itself. This is used to be the purview of a strict crime analysis, and it was the purview of almost nobody before the crime analyst was hired. And it is now at the lowest level possible where an officer can sit down and click two buttons and get to a heat map of crime and their beats. There is a component here for public access. So remember, the public can log into the website and get heat information, crime information for their neighborhoods. Also, component of this, I should mention on writer reports, public access to be able to submit reports is being updated. That process is being updated on the back end for officers to approve it, and officer also for the public to submit police reports. That's part of the project as well. And I think that is it. Questions?
Any members of the committee have any questions? Starting on the left, Dwight. And make sure you speak into the microphone. Not all the bugs are worked out of this system yet.
Got it. I have two questions. Will the system enable the officers to, down the long run, close more cases?
That is one of the intents of the new records management system, to be able to manage better cases that they're investigating from a investigative standpoint. We have very little in our current system for case management. Open cases assigned to detectives, assigned to officers. This manages them much better, and it provides them with a ton more information, CAD information, the ability to do Google searches, Google-type searches. So if you've got a partial phone number, right now the process, if you've got a partial phone number, even a partial license plate, searching our system currently is a multi-step, half an hour, two-hour process.
Understand.
Under this scenario, it's a Google search. And so getting that information back quickly is easy.
My second question has to do with, there are some public access sites that tend to try to provide crime map information on the internet. And they are, they're sometimes good, they're sometimes very weak, and sometimes very slow in getting data. Will they have access to something like this? And will this potentially speed up their reporting and make their reporting more accurate?
Right now, the police department uses a website, crimereports.com, I believe. And that information is live as soon as it's entered into the old system. The new software will be similar. You'll be able to set up alerts. You'll be able to look at specific neighborhoods. You'll still have, though, for privacy reasons, dots in 100 blocks. There won't be dots at 211 Main Street that there was a robbery at 200 Main Street.
Yeah.
But we'll also have the ability, if we get to that point, to add CAD information, calls for service information, a lot more data that we'll be collecting into that public access.
Thank you.
Any more questions from the left? Any questions from the right?
I'm sorry, I was just surprised no one asked a question. I'm ready.
Thank you very much for that presentation. With the Near Me purchase, it wasn't clear to me if that's an access, if that interfaces with public records, or is that Near Me is the source of the data as well?
Near Me is a tool for the law enforcement user, for the officer, for the community service officer. It's both a communication device or communication method for a crime analyst to identify a zone or a beat that's got a problem. They could drive, you know, this neighborhood's got increased burglaries, and attach a lot of information to it. An officer on the beat will pull it up and look at it on his or her mobile device or his or her laptop. It is intended strictly for the public safety user. Public access at this point has been discussed by the vendor, but it is not there yet for making some of that information available to the public to be able to get information. Say there's a burglary in the area, and it's in a near me situation, and be able to put that like on the public website and get information for the public. It's not being developed yet at this point.
So the information that Near Me is providing is not information that, with a little digging, would be available to the public?
Correct.
That's correct, okay. Because if it is, I was going to say, if we're spending money, let's make it available to the public as soon as possible. So I heard about the, in the event of a fire or something, that it's kept elsewhere. Can information also be exported periodically, pulled off this so that we have our own backup, so we're not relying on this company to which we have a contract to store it on the cloud. Is it possible for the in-house records that we can access if we decide at some point we don't want to use this company anymore?
We do. The equipment we're purchasing is two separate computer systems that the city owns. City maintains the databases. So it's not owned by the company. It's not kept that. Those ones are not kept in the cloud. It's kept both here within the confines of City Hall and an offsite location. But we maintain them. We own them. It's not. There is a separate copy kept at what's called NLEDS, which is a national law enforcement database system that is encrypted offsite for offsite storage, but it is not accessed. It's just basically a backup. Our main backups and our main use are owned by the city maintainers.
Right. So the information that is going both ways, we are retaining that history, that data, that knowledge, that investment here in the community, not providing it one way.
Correct.
To a contractor.
Yeah.
Great. And I liked the what I saw, the numbers there, and investment in the public safety. And I'm wondering, I did see a category there called system management or something like that. So I was wondering if in this, there are local jobs created here at the city for help desk, helping to manage the system, training people here, rather than calling a helpline or working with the company. Are there jobs created here in Salinas because of using this cutting edge technology?
The line item you saw for project management,
mm-hmm,
is me. when the system goes live, we will be using internal administrators for internal training, internal management from our new police network administrator position. And we will have a support contract with Tritech in case something breaks. And in addition to that, there is a contract that they provide update training annually. But other than that, outside of the police organization, there is no need, no intent to hire additional staff.
There's no bonus of hiring additional staff in this current plan?
Other than police employees.
Got it. The last question is, will it be rolled out or phased in or all at once? I was looking at that crime view and thinking, boy, that would be great to have that as soon as possible. But is it all, when it all goes live at the same time?
It will go live at the same time.
Great, thank you very much.
I noticed when you explained how the officers then can just talk the report into, you know, when you explained that, I know now they end up having to come back and write all these reports up and all this goes on and it's extra time for them. How much time do you think that will save the officers?
We have not done a true cost-benefit analysis to find that, but anecdotally, the review process will be substantially cut. Just the review process. It is still remains to be seen about the entry. A huge factor is to make sure we give officers and users and community service officers the tools to remain on the street and remain effective, not to have to come back into the station and use technology. And so this provides that. How much time will it save? We don't know. So, but it will save time.
Thank you. It seemed like it will be considerable.
Okay, last call on my way.
What is the reaction of the police department, police officers rather, to having to do the data entry?
It is mixed, and what we're finding is with any technology now, there is an increased level of acceptance in new technology. It was important for us to find a records management system that was web browser based and that was borrowing from best practices both in public safety but also in technology. So you'll see Google based searches type functionality. So there is a trade-off. there is a trade-off that officers will need to sit down and do some of the entry, but the way it's built, that there will not be a duplication of work involved. It'll all be single entry. Anything that is done by a dispatcher for that officer will be available for the officer just to click on it and drag it into the dispatch report. So there's some time savings.
We tried a very rudimentary version of that many years ago, and the reaction was not positive.
Right.
Will the old data from the current system be transferred to the new system?
The part of the contract is for them to do conversion, and we're working on that now. So we're hoping that all 30 years can come over into the new system.
Actually, it's more than 30 years, because yeah. I started on that process in 1981.
That was before I was born.
Well, good. I'm glad we're catching up. Thank you.
Any more questions on the right?
I have a question. This Tri-Tech Systems, is it being implemented in other police departments? And have we got any statistical data as to the effectiveness, because I know the question was asked earlier about the time it's going to save our officers in the field. So is it being utilized somewhere else?
There are 3,000, around the United States, there are 3,000 entities, agencies using records management systems from Tri-Tech software. And each agency we have found is unique in how they do records management. We're part of that uniqueness. So to say that, you know, because an agency like Long Beach or Santa Monica is using it, and they saved X, that we would save that same, because our old system was not like their old system. So that kind of one for one is not possible. But what I can tell you is that, just as an example, an officer needs to look at a mugshot of someone. They've got to drive from their beat into the station, sit down, log in, go to the separate system, pull up a picture. Under this system, it's all there and it's mobile. If they want to do a lineup, if they want to do another search, it's all mobile. So anecdotally, we know that it's going to be time savings. For an officer to enter a piece of property, a federal property, it's a separate system that's driving to the station. This was a competitive bid process, so there were 8 vendors from the United States who bid, and there was a large cross-section of the police department that was involved in reviewing those bids. There was well over 3,000 functional requirements to meet, and those functional requirements were designed by the users. We also took into account the recommendations from the COPS office, and maintaining data and increasing our ability to analyze data at the lowest level, whether it's use of force data, whether it's investigative data. That was all taken into account in deciding that Tri-Tech was the vendor that would most fit our needs.
Any more questions on the right? Dolores?
When a new facility is built, will it facilitate the system? When a new facility is built, will the system be able to be in that building?
Absolutely. One of the pieces of hardware that we currently have in the city hall will move to the new police building, and it's built for expansion. So absolutely, I mean, that was part of the design. When there's a new police building, not if now, when. Great, thank you.
Any more questions on the right?
No, I just made a note to ask about the new police building.
Okay, does any member of the audience have any questions for Mr. Mofino? Seeing none, committee member comments? None on the left, none on the right? Oh, okay, I missed you. Wait.
Very short.
Okay, thank you for the presentation. And we will now move on to the, get back to the agenda where we were on public comments. If you have any comments for the committee, step up to the podium. Please limit yourself to 3 minutes and keep it on police issues.
Good evening. My name is Al Escondola, and I recognize some of you. The last time I came to one of your meetings, you didn't have a quorum. And it looks like you're well represented tonight, which is nice. One of the things I wanted to say that we had a little conversation earlier, a couple of us, is when you hold your meetings, it would be very nice if you provided an agenda to those from the public so we can follow what you're doing and maybe speak on the items that interest us. Also, I looked for the minutes for past meetings and was not able to secure them off the web. I don't know where they're at. I don't know if you guys have a clerk assigned for your committee or not, but you might want to look into that. My other issue is from my neighborhood. We're suffering a spike in crime, lots of shootings out there, and I know the chief is doing his best to try to hire new officers, but it's like you take two steps forward and one step back in some cases. And I would hope that maybe, not as a brain trust, I don't want to go that far, but this committee could work in conjunction with the police department on what they might do to help secure some new police officers. Sometimes talking about the issue allows positive dialogue to come out by just discussing it. Because we're very fearful for our lives. I live in Alisal, and it's not just the Alisal that is having this problem. But when you have people being shot and you're being told they're not gang related, then what they're doing is they're just shooting residents. And I have a big concern about that. Thank you. Thank you for your volunteer.
Thank you.
Gloria Moore, I would just like to compliment all of you that are here this evening and compliment your appointers. I've come for over a year now, and having a quorum at these meetings has been almost impossible. I think this is a good sign to Chief McMillan, letting him know that this can be a group that can function and attend meetings and have an interest in what the police department is doing. There have been some wonderful presentations that have been ready for these meetings. It takes an officer, a representative from the police department, time to put that together. To arrive here and not have a quorum is very, very disappointing. So it's great to see all of you. Let's hope you can keep it up. There's still a couple vacancies. So next time we hope that you're all squeezed in a little bit closer and there's 14 of you here to ask those vital questions that those of us who are out in the community would like to have the opportunity to ask. So thank you.
Thank you.
Marianne Worden. I'm really happy to see all of you here tonight. I was one of the first persons that was the first group of police advisory. Let me tell you, I didn't think I wanted to do this, not when I was told I had a right with the police. That was one thing I didn't aim for in my life. But they talked me into it, and I did it, and I fell in love with it. Plus, I fell in love with our officers. Is very, very important if you're going to be in this program or committee, please make sure you do right with your officers. You learn so much of what they have to put up with and what they're doing without. When I wrote, they didn't have phones, they didn't have computers, they didn't have any of that. They didn't have restrooms either to go to unless they went to a gas station or a restaurant. Okay, that's the truth. They know it. So being able to run with them and see the problems they had to deal with, we were, as a committee, were able to come back to our council
and ask for some of these things. And we have received it, so now I'm really happy with the new technology we're getting, because they didn't have any of it. But please come to the meetings and go to your neighborhood meetings and listen to the problems those neighbors are having and let them know that you're concerned about them and you're there to help them, because that's the main part, not just coming to this meeting. There's a lot more involved with it, and you really need to be dedicated. I did it for 6 years. I probably put about $100 a year doing that. Just writing. Now, we were only supposed to require to do 40. I don't know what we're required to do now. But it was an education, and that's how I got involved with our police and our communities and knowing the problems we have and being able to help some of our communities. So please, if you're going to do this, be dedicated to it, because it's one of the most valuable things I've ever done. And I really appreciate getting to know our officers. Most of them are retiring or have retired, and we've got a bunch of new ones. But I'm very proud of the ones that I came across and worked with. They've been like a second family to me, or second children to me, the men and the women both. So please, be there for them, advise them, and I know my minutes are up, but it's nice to see all of you here, and I'll try to make it more often over here, but you know, I'm 80 years old, so I'm just... but please go to your neighborhood meetings and learn what the problems are. Thank you.
Thank you. Does anybody else wish to address the committee?
Sandy Whittle, and this question is for the chief. Last night, the city council approved $1.5 million for is this a comprehensive package, or is it just the mechanism to tell where the shots are fired from, or is the camera element included?
So she, can you remind her she's addressing the committee and not the staff?
This is one of the problems that we have.
Yeah, if you could kindly address the committee.
Well, the question is for the chief.
So make your statement, and then it will hold, and then the committee will take it up. This is public comment, where we're hearing public comments, and then we act on what you say.
Well, this isn't how it was done before, Karen.
Well, those
yeah, we can't, that, we can't act on anything right now anyway.
Yeah, those are the rules.
Well.
And under public comment, nobody is supposed to answer questions anyway. So.
Exactly.
So public comments, you can make comments to us, but we cannot act on them because they're not on the agenda. That's what we've got in the right act.
Thank you.
Well, why was this not done when I sat on PCAC?
I can't answer that.
Thank you.
Anybody else wish to address the committee?
This resident. Just want to throw it out there, you know, this is supposed to be a community advisory committee, so maybe we should try getting some input from more of the public, having some outside, since apparently people aren't really coming in here. Maybe we need to go out to them and try to make more dialogue and connection with, because, you know, they're doing a great job, but doesn't mean there's not room for improvement, and same with the community, you know, I mean, most people are responsible. There's still tidbits of information that could be useful to them as well, to follow the law and make sure they can stay out of trouble. I think one of the biggest things is just getting to know each other and meet each other, because then, and it's not in the drive-by mode of just drive-by policing, but, you know, just actually interacting, okay, I recognize that face, I can halfway trust that person to some degree or something, you know, just a little bit more rapport. And I think that's kind of something that would be great to have in a community advisory committee, more community, since is not here, maybe we need to go out to the public.
Thank you. Does anybody else wish to address the committee? Seeing none, we'll move on to the next agenda item, which is the consent agenda, which consists only of the minutes. Does any member of the committee have any corrections or additions to the minutes?
Mr. Chair?
Go ahead.
Under item two, it says public comments from Steve, unknown last name. His name is Eklund, E-K-L-U-N-D. Mr. Eklund took time out to come speak to us, E-K-L-U-N-D.
And I've got a, I probably wasn't clear, but when I made it, I made a comment about the Port Arbor Youth Authority getting a 3% raise, and it's not all Port Arbor employees, it's just the Port Arbor Youth Authority. There's some employees out there probably who love to get a 3% raise. Any other corrections or additions? Do we have a motion to approve the minutes? We have a motion by Wayne. Do we have a second? Richard? Any discussion of the motion? All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Passed unanimously. Okay, one abstention. Okay, Chief's report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's a banner night for PCAC. You don't realize that you just shattered our all-time attendance record. Seriously, so, I mean, I appreciate Wes's comments that the public's not here, but I'm telling you, man, this is standing room only compared to what we're used to. So keep coming. And I would say that if you had attended in the past, for instance, Al, you would have heard a presentation by our personnel and training folks on what we are trying to do locally. We had a long conversation about hiring here. We've had presentations on how internal affairs investigations work, how when we got our rescue vehicle, which caused some controversy, how we developed a policy around that that was reviewed by this body, and in fact, with some of the input from this committee, I changed the policy to reflect some really important things that we had overlooked at the police department, and this committee made some important recommendations to that. So I think one of the things I'm often critiqued about is not bringing certain things to this committee, but I think that if you're a regular attendee, you would also see that we do discuss a lot of things that you don't hear about in other places, that you will only hear about here. But you have to participate. You have to be here to see that. And then before I get into the meat of that, I'd like to just, by way of history, acknowledge the great strides this committee has made. When I became the chief of police, this committee met. And it's a Brown Act committee. We're governed by the rules of the Brown Act. We met in the West Wing conference room. And when the committee committee started, half the time the door had shut and we'd lock people out and wonder why the public didn't show up. To Ms. Whittle's concern about coming up during public comment and asking a question and being told we can't answer that question, the committee is correct. The Brown Act does not allow for, it's not a Q&A session. It's public comment, not public question. Those are Brown Act rules, but because the committee ran kind of fast and loose for so long, it was more of a chat group than anything else. We engaged in that dialogue. We would ask questions and kind of run willy-nilly over the Brown Act because nobody was keeping an eye on us. And so, and the chief police didn't come to these meetings. I've missed very few of these meetings since I've been the chief, and that has not always been the case. And because I think it's important for the chief to be here. And so my hat's off to the committee for coming out into the bright light of the rotunda, to you all to be here to keep eyes on us and give us your important input. So thank you for that. Now, in terms of my actual update, I, oddly enough, to Ms. Sandy's question, yes, last night the council approved the expenditure of $1.5 million for ShotSpotter. ShotSpotter is a gunshot detection program. It has been discussed in this committee quite a long time ago when we were discussing technology. It did not come back to you before it went to council last night, and I take full responsibility for that. What ShotSpotter is a gunshot detection program based on a sonic array that is set up around the city. So sensors are set up in various locations throughout the city, and they listen for gunfire. When a gunshot is detected, the sensors will triangulate on that position, and that is immediately electronically sent to a ShotSpotter engineer, a live human being who's on duty, and they analyze that acoustic signature to ensure that it is a gunshot, that it is not a backfire, it is not a firework. And then as soon as that signature is validated, it gets immediately sent back through this very important system that Commander Molfino just described for us. It goes out to our dispatchers, it goes to our command staff, and it goes out to every police officer logged on to the system, generally from shot fired to report in a police car of the location. Time of the shot is less than a minute. ShotSpotter guarantees 10 meters of accuracy, that they're going to tell you within 10 meters of where that shot came from. In reality, they're about 1 meter accurate, so they're telling you exactly where that gunshot happened. Now, the clear benefit to this is there is no photographic capability. That has never been part of ShotSpotter's repertoire. I would like to supplement that with cameras. I would like to supplement ShotSpotter with mobile, with stationary license plate readers, so that we can see cars coming and going and understand which vehicles are moving. There's a variety of things that we can do to enhance the system, none of which I just described is free. It's all really expensive, and we're lucky to have a grant from the state to pay that $1.5 million. And so that system, and importantly, I want people to understand this. ShotSpotter is a gunfire detection system. It does not, it cannot pick up human voice, music, conversation. It's not Big Brother listening, and it is rigged to understand gunfire signatures. That's all that it does. Although they are trying to engineer it now to be able to detect the location of fireworks, illegal fireworks that are being launched. Wouldn't that be interesting in Salinas? To be able to see where you can go. I'd be afraid to see what our computers do when they start bringing up that information. So, a couple of items relative to the Collaborative Reform Initiative, which is the Department of Justice report. Progress has been made. The committee's aware that I've changed. One of their big recommendations was that we change our policy on who investigates officer-involved shootings. A few months ago, I shifted the responsibility for investigating Salinas Police Department officer-involved shootings from our office to the office of the district attorney. We have, since I made that transition, had one officer-involved shooting. Luckily, it was not fatal. It actually resulted in a very minor injury. The district attorney did take lead on that investigation, so that is in process. I mean, that is completed. A number of the collaborative reform recommendations are around PCAC, I have elected to not act on many of those recommendations because the city council is still reviewing all of the committees and commissions in the city, and this subcommittee is going to make recommendations to the larger council on how we proceed forward. And so I don't want to start making recommendations about PCAC until the city council is fully informed on which way they want to go. Because as some of you who have been around for a while recall, that we did an extensive review of our bylaws prior to September of 2014. On September 30th, 2014, we had a study session with the city council just on PCAC, where we recommended a number of bylaws changes. The city council elected not to act on those bylaws changes. They took no action, and to this date have not acted on those bylaws changes. So we're still in a holding pattern. Now, what one of the advantages of, one of the benefits of participating in the Collaborative Reform Initiative is that they offer technical assistance. So not only do they make recommendations for changes that they think will benefit the department and the community, they will also support tech training and technical assistance to advance those. So one of the recommendations for technical assistance that we're taking up on is we are going to send a staff member and council member Jim Lutz, who is on the subcommittee for committees of your effective assessment. She's looking at all the rules about the committees. We're going to send them to, it's called the NACOLE conference, N-A-C-O-L-E, National Association for Civilian Oversight of Law Enforcement. And so this is the group of people that provide civilian oversight to police agencies. There's some really big ones that are that have a lot of control over the police departments, to advisory committees, much like your own, everything in between. And we're very confident that Sergeant Johnson and Councilmember Lutz are going to be able to come back with some really good recommendations to make regarding how PCAC looks going forward. And so we'll be excited to hear a report back. In fact, I shouldn't be in the business of asking council members to come and do presentations to committees, but I think it would be interesting to hear what she learns from that NACOLE committee. That's going to take place in late September. We are also sending a team of police department staff to the Seattle Police Department. Seattle is a national leader in de-escalation training and policy. We are working on our de-escalation policy, and just to let everybody know what that means is the de-escalation is something that we've done for a long time. We just didn't call it that. So what de-escalation says is if you are in an encounter with someone and it looks like there is going to be a use of force, what are the techniques that you can do, that we can do as police officers, to minimize use of force or to eliminate use of force? What are the options available to us? How do we go from a lethal confrontation to a less lethal confrontation, or from a less lethal confrontation to a non-physical confrontation? What are the skills that police officers should consider? What are the things we should consider? And these are things like, am I dealing with someone who's mentally ill? Am I dealing with someone who's high on drugs? Would it be a benefit to get further away from this individual? Would it be a benefit, and do I have time to call in professional help? That's what de-escalation is all about. And so we're sending a crew to Seattle to see how they're training their department, what their policy looks like, and how they implemented it, so we can be smart and thoughtful about ours. And then I will also remind you that there are a few recommendations that I am not going to act on as your chief of police. And I'm not going to, because they have very important long-term ramifications to the police department. And so I think are the rightful purview of the next chief of police. Those are primarily around use of force policy and community engagement policy. And those policies, particularly use of force, is really embedded in state and federal law. And I have pretty strong feelings about tampering with those policies, because they also expose people to a great deal of liability. And community engagement policy is, I think, going to be very, very dependent on what your next chief feels is important, on which way they want to approach. There are a variety of ways to approach community engagement. And so I don't want to set in policy something that may not fit with the next chief of police's worldview of how community engagement should go. I wouldn't want to take over a police department where the outgoing boss just made a bunch of sweeping changes and said, have a nice day, and retired. I think those are going to have to wait. And then the last update for the committee is it has to do with the recent violence we have. We have, as you all know, a terrible weekend of firearms violence in Salinas, which is capped off a terrible month of firearms violence in Salinas. And you'll recall that in July of 2015, because of our staffing crisis, We eliminated all the special units, including our gang units at the police department, brought everybody back to patrol and detectives, got away from traffic gangs, school resource officers, place-based police officers, or community police officers, everybody came back to patrol. We did that because we only had 136 police officers, and that's not enough. We could not meet our minimum staffing levels, and we had also just received the Measure G money, so it was supposed to be a temporary fix until we could hire more police officers. Well, we've been hiring like crazy. I think since July, we've probably hired about 35 police officers. Don't hold me to that, it's pretty close though. Remember I said in July of 2015 we had 136 police officers? Today, we have 135. Net minus one. This morning we started with 136, to this afternoon we're at 135. And so that's kind of a long way of saying our staffing hasn't gotten any better, because we're still, we lose police officers to other departments, we lose them to retirements, we lose them to medical issues, industrial retirements, things like that. So we've been on this one-for-one ratio for a while. I think that's going to change for the better here pretty soon. But the question remains, what are we doing with what we have? And the fact of the matter is, with just patrol and detectives, we are not anywhere near addressing the firearms violence problem in a meaningful way. And so, to the detriment of patrol, I am intent on re-establishing the violence suppression unit. It's going to be a mere shell of its former self, two officers and a sergeant. But it's a critical component in anti-gang enforcement, anti-gang anti-violence work, because with just patrol and investigations, there's no central repository for intelligence, actionable information from informants, collaboration with local, state, and federal partners. None of that stuff happens unless we have the infrastructure, however thin, to support it at the police department. So beginning in about 2 weeks, we will have a very small but I'm confident, mighty violence suppression unit to begin to address this violence problem that we've seen in Salinas for the last couple of years. Mr. Chairman, that concludes my report, and be happy to answer any questions.
Any committee members with questions for Chief McMillan, starting on my right this time?
Maybe one question in regards to the violence suppression unit, because I know that I was part of the meetings back in 15 when you had to pull your officers, but are we still working collaboratively with other agencies, like all the way to King City, our highway patrol? Are we still actively utilizing their services as well?
So we are. To the extent that we can. Well, the way we have been addressing gang violence is through what we call an ad hoc team. So one of our really good gang enforcement supervisors runs a crew of officers that do this on overtime, which is not particularly effective, but it's better than nothing. And so they will work with parole agents, probation officers, allied agencies, sheriffs, deputies, federal partners. But because it's on a kind of catch-as-catch-can ad hoc basis, it hasn't been a consistent effort. So that's one issue. The other issue is, we often call on the sheriff and the highway patrol to come in and help us out. And I have made that call again, but the reports that I get back are their staffing isn't really any better than ours. And, the sheriff is still committed to fires, that they're consuming a lot of the sheriff's resources, and so does the highway patrol. Plus, they're at all-time staffing lows, like we are as well. So, one of the things that we anticipate with the permanent, with the formation of a full-time unit, is we'll be able to leverage resources more consistently, particularly, I think, at the federal level.
Any other questions from the right side?
Any questions from Chief McMillan on the left side? I just have a couple questions, and I don't know if you can answer them because they have to do with the hiring process for your replacement. Are you able to answer questions on that subject?
I can try. I will tell you if I can.
Okay, what I've heard, and I'm basically just looking for who was on the committee from residents, and I heard that a couple of the members of that committee left the meeting basically in protest.
So that's an appropriate question for the city manager. I didn't have anything to do. That's an appropriate question for the city manager. I did not have anything to do with any of the selection committees. I did not participate on any of these.
Okay, thank you. Oh, one other thing. I don't remember if it was you when you first became chief or Chief Federal, but somebody at one point said that they were going to start supplying us with the sheet that comes out every week on staffing. Any chance we can get that? You know, how many are available, how many aren't?
Yeah, I think so. I just have to make sure that there's no... Sometimes there's medical information on them, so I just have to make sure that it's basically okay to publish, to disseminate as a public document. Can you make a note, please, to check on that comes out of personal training?
Yeah, the ones I've seen haven't had names or anything. I've just been numbers.
Yeah, I believe I can, but I just need to check to make sure that it qualifies as a public document.
Does any member of the public have any questions for Chief McMillan?
You comments, public comments. We don't do questions. Right?
Okay. Well, we're done with that one then.
No, you can certainly have public comment.
Oh, public comment. Oh, you want to, okay, you missed public comments. Comment no, anyway.
No, on this?
Yeah.
So to be clear, Mr. Chairman, you're asking for public comment.
I'm asking for questions for Chief McMillan.
And I just want to remind people that this is public comment, yeah. Not public question, because I'm not supposed to answer this.
So for clarity, the public can always be heard.
They rearrange the room and we all get lost.
Yeah. No. So for clarity, the public can always ask or present comment to you on anything not on the agenda, and that's usually on your agenda. And then they can speak to every item on the agenda, but it doesn't necessarily have to be addressed. It can be, but it doesn't necessarily have to. As an example, might be they don't know the answer, they're going to look into it. I'm sure the chief would, right?
Well,
so there were a few things, and I want to thank the chief for giving a report to this body, and it's nice to see that there is a nice full body in the room. I think I am very interested in this body having a little bit more input on what is happening with the police department and feedback. I think it's very important, especially in light of the report that came out of the Department of Justice. And the training that was mentioned by the chief, I think it's also very important that there be a budget that is set for this particular body, and that representatives of this body have the ability to go to those trainings and see not only what is being presented, but to talk to people like-minded, like yourselves, that have had the same issues going on in their communities, exchange ideas and hear what's going on across the country, and also have an opportunity to expand your own knowledge base. And so I would suggest to you that you advocate for that, you push for that, because after all, that's what you're here for, right? To be the eyes and ears of the community, and I very much appreciate that you are here today. I wanted to also, I wanted to thank the chief for his time. I know he's gonna be leaving soon. I do think that there should be more input, not only by this body, but members of the community on the new hire, and I would like to state that I think that it's important that the new incoming chief he's somebody who is bilingual and can communicate with over 75% of the population that does speak another language. I think that's very important, especially in light of the problems that have gone on. And these are all things that we have to move forward on, because, you know, it's given us a real black eye, but we have to move forward and
one of the ways that we're going to move forward is that we look at the report. I don't know if everybody's had an opportunity to view the report and read it, but that you, so that you're aware of some of the issues and some of the recommendations coming out of the Department of Justice, especially as it relates to transparency and the public and your role with the public and expanding that role. And I'd like to thank you again very much.
Thank you. Does anybody else have questions for Chief McMillan?
My name is James Ang, and I'm concerned about the number of police officers that we have in Salinas. And from what I understand from what Mr. McMillan said, he said we hired 35 the last couple of months, and now we're down to the same level as we did a couple of months ago. So I would like to know exactly what these officers are thinking when they come, get hired, and they leave. I think we need to address each person that gets trained and decides to leave, what their thoughts are, what are they thinking, why are they leaving for other places or deciding not to become a police officer. These are important points that we need to find out so we can keep them on board. Maybe they don't like the 10-12 hour shifts that they have to do. I don't know what exactly the reason, but we need to talk to each one of these officers that are trained and leave to find out what their thoughts are.
Thank you. Any other questions for Chief McMillan? Seeing none, we'll move on to the next agenda item, which is future agenda items. And this is also
PCAC
community. What?
Under items to be discussed, PCAC community meetings.
PCAC community. PCAC community meetings. Do we have any report on how we've got anything?
Yes, we do. At the last meeting, we were discussing community meetings and what it might take to have one, as we are charged to do. So I volunteered to look into it to see what the city policies were on doing that, insurance, any requirements. So I was able to put together some information in that there isn't a lot of strict regular rules around us having a community meeting as far as the policy of the city goes. As long as we handle it as Brown Act, the Brown Act requires, they're cool with that. There also is no cost, additional cost to the city because they have built in additional insured insurance for us to go out, liability insurance, to use other buildings to have our meetings in. This, of course, is always an option here, but we talked about maybe what would it be like in other parts of town. I looked into North Salinas and found several schools there that have very adequate space for community meetings. Also across the street, the former Armory, that is another space that is available. I went to a wonderful ceremony there and met the person in charge of that. That space is also available to us. So costs involved would be staff time, of course, if there are any non-salaried staff members that are assigned to be there with us, and custodial time if our event runs beyond the normal hours of whatever custodial staff is at the school. But normal attend, you know, they're on duty weeknights till about 10 or 11. So that was about it. I spoke with Patricia Barajas in the city clerk's office, who researched if there were any policies, and that's what I came away with.
Any questions from Karen, starting on my left? Any questions for Karen on my right? Any public comments on the report? Seeing none. Any committee member comments? Okay, Margaret.
Well, that was passed. Did somebody have a comment?
Into the microphone, please.
Yes. I'm not used to walking over here, at least.
I know. We're trying to fix that.
Okay,
Margaret said that, Benetti. Thank you, Karen, for looking into that. I think it's an excellent idea that you take this body out into the rest of Salinas, which is expands, goes across the other side of the road, goes into East Salinas, goes into North Salinas, and then you meet with people in the neighborhoods that they live in so that they know that you exist and they feel a little bit more comfortable talking to you, sharing their ideas, sharing their problems, sharing their concerns, and once they get past all of that, moving forward in order to make things better for the community, you know, what the concerns that they have with Salinas, and it's all about trust, and you've got to help. And I think that that's one of the reasons why you're here, is so that you can help build that trust. And so if they feel that you're out there in their communities, they're gonna see that you care about them. Right now, there are a lot of people in Salinas that don't feel that the city really cares about them. But it's not just the city, it's all across the country, really. People don't feel like anybody cares about them. And I think that one of the ways that to rectify that is to alleviate it, is to go out there and do that. And so I commend Karen for going as far as she says to look into this. I encourage you to do it. If there's anything that I can do as a former school board member, anything else in my community, help to make it happen, please let me know. I'm at your disposal. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments from the public? Okay, now we're back to the committee for comments. Wayne?
Well, first, thank you, Karen, for looking into that. We now know that it's legal to do so, but that's about as much as we know at the moment. I suggest that some of us who are interested in this matter, that obviously should be everybody on the committee, but at any rate, that we have some kind of a planning session to decide what kind of a meeting we would have, whether we would just move this meeting somewhere else in the city, or whether we would develop some new agenda or new procedure for getting people involved, because wow, this is very valuable information. It really doesn't get us any closer to having a community meeting. Thank you.
Mr. Chair, I would be willing to be part of a subcommittee that would put together a recommendation with other folks for consideration at the next meeting.
Any other committee member comments besides Mary?
I have a.
Well, let's separate this into comments and then volunteers for the subcommittee. Any other comments?
Here.
Go ahead, Mary. Okay.
Well, on the revised bylaws that are still in limbo, and God knows when they'll ever be real, it is stated that we will have a minimum of 2, possibly 3 community meetings per year. And it's also recommended that we team up, you know, maybe by district or whatever, to establish those community meetings, just as a bit of information.
Any other? Okay, there we go. Any other comments? Now, who are the volunteers? That's 4, that's a good size subcommittee.
And it doesn't violate the Brown Act, for those of you that are noticing changes in how we're operating. So it can't be a majority of people on the board, right? We can't have just enough to make a decision. I have Wayne, Thomas, and Karen.
And Linda.
Yeah.
Great. Okay, who would like to convene the 4 of us?
How about you, since it's your idea?
No, it was Wayne's idea.
Everybody, I'm not recurring.
I'd be happy to convene us.
Of course.
Okay.
So you're going to do it?
I will convene.
Okay. Okay, we're done with that item. Last item is future agenda items, which would include committee member comments. We'll start on my left again.
I missed her name, but I just wanted to say I really like her energy, because I do believe that we all need to get out there and,
name again?
Please, Tom. I'm kidding. Margaret.
Margaret, thank you. Some of the things that I'm doing just in my neighborhood is Karen and I have actually organized a neighborhood watch, and we're working with Sergeant Johnson. And we started using the Nextdoor app recently at our last neighborhood watch meeting, and that seems to be very helpful with communication. I've actually gone to meetings at Lorna and Mission Park and worked with Dwight just to figure out what's working in different parts of Salinas, you know, and kind of do a good, better, how. What's good? What could be better? How are we going to do it? This traffic calming flyer, I'm proud to say that we got the traffic calmed on Massanell Street because we got our neighbors united, as in our neighborhood watch name, and that we're going to have the first solar-powered traffic speed feedback signs on both ends of Massanell Street, and that's going to be coming next month, working with James Serrano at the city. One of the things that I brought up last meeting is to look into pay and the benefits for the police officers. I know the cost of living on the Central Coast is expensive, and that might be one of the reasons I taught in Alisal for 12 years, because they paid more when they hired me. So that was, you know, one of the reasons I chose East Salinas instead of, say, Pacific Grove. Same thing with the officers, you know, look into pay and benefits. And then I always come back to, I wanted to compliment, I like how we're looking at what other cities are doing, what's working, and starting to implement that as far as technology, what's going on in Seattle. That's exciting. But I always come full circle back to education. You know, I say at every meeting, I feel like a broken record, but I don't think anything's really going to change until we start reaching out to the youth and really educating our youth and having those communication, you know, open communication with what's going on. And you know, being an educator of 19 years, and I've been here for 12, and what's been going on recently, it's, you know, I've got my wife saying I'm ready to move, and I don't want to leave, so I'm hoping that things get better, but hope and pray is not going to do much. So I think it's going to take everybody, you know, getting excited, like Margaret, and excited in a way like, let's make change happen right now, on a local level, so thank you.
Any other, on my left side? Any comments on the right side? No worse.
Future agenda items?
Future agenda items?
I think we need to talk more about that spot shooter.
The shot spotter?
Fire, yes.
It's tongue twister.
Okay. Any other future agenda items or committee member comments?
First, I'd like to thank the chief for his report, and as the time gets closer to his departure, I have a little sad part of my heart to see him leave. I think you've been an extremely, your mentorship, your involvement with the city of Salinas, the hard work that you've done, the sacrifices that I know you've made over the years, for me personally and my family is going to be greatly missed. But I, because I've just retired recently myself, I can tell you that you are moving into a wonderful area and time of your life. But I do want you to know personally for myself that you will be missed. And hopefully, as was mentioned earlier, whoever steps into your shoes is going to have a large size to fill. Another comment I wanted to make in reference to a comment that was already made in reference to one of the representatives from this committee being a part of that civilian advocacy, conference that's coming up. I think I've made some inquiries about that. I'm very interested in it as a member of this commission. And so if something can come of that, I would really love to be if they would consider having me as a part of that advocacy. And then just excited to know that now that we've had some clarification from Karen in regards to the community meetings, and that we can can move forward with that. I'm excited to be on a volunteer on that committee and look forward to meeting, because I've served on committees before and I know that it's very important that we interface with the community that we live in order to address some of the problems, the horrific problems that we're facing with violence in our community. And so the sooner we get started with those community meetings and having them placed all over is going to be a very important step for this committee right here, I think, for our to be, so that the community can value that we do value them, and so that they can value us as well. And that's it.
Thank you. Any other committee member comments? My only comment is kind of a brief one. On Monday, I ran into a blast from the past, Neil Harrier, former police officer here, who looks good in retirement. So I'm not going to tell too many people, because that would encourage retirements, wouldn't it? Okay, we're adjourned. Thank you. Thanks for everybody who came.